Welcome back to Coding Math. I haven't put out any episodes in a few months due to some other commitments. Actually, one of the biggest commitments I had was creating a full video-based course on JavaScript for another company. This was a direct result of this whole series, I'm happy to say. The course called Foundations of JavaScript will be over at the Aquint Gymnasium. It'll be free and open to anyone who wants to sign up for it. I'll have some more info on it when it actually goes live, and there are actually already several other free courses over there that you may find interesting. Anyway, I've received a lot of comments, emails, and tweets in the recent months asking when I'd be back, and the channel is still getting new subscribers and positive comments, and even some new donations at patreon.com. So I'm very happy to report that I am now back in business. So this is episode 27. In episodes 22 through 26, I was going over some basic 3D concepts. Now I'm not done there, but I think I'm going to go off in some different directions for a few episodes until I get my footing back here. So today I want to cover the basics of easing and tweening. I'll probably break this up into a few different videos covering the concepts and some simple easing in this video, and then some more complex examples, and finally onto full tweening. Now the terms tweening and easing both have to do with the idea of moving an object from a given position to another known position. These are related concepts, and the words are often used interchangeably, although technically easing is one aspect of tweening. More on that later. In summary, though, tweening means that something is currently sitting at this spot here, and I want to move it over to this spot right here. Now realize that this is a lot different than what we were doing earlier with various physics concepts such as velocity, acceleration, and friction. In those examples, we had an object at a given position, and we set it moving at a certain rate and direction and with various forces and just let it go. With friction, the object would eventually come to a stop. But in general, we would have no idea exactly where it would wind up beforehand. Now with easing or tweening, we know exactly where we want the object to end up, and we obviously know where it is now. We just need to know how to make it move there smoothly. As you might imagine, the physics formulas are far more useful for things like games or other simulations, but easing and tweening have their place mainly in user interfaces, where you might want to slide a particular element into place and slide another one out. Now before I go much further, note that although I'm probably going to talk in terms of position, easing and tweening can be applied to any numeric property of an object. You can tween the rotation, the size, or the scale, or the opacity or alpha of a visible object, for example. You could also tween between different colors, as colors are really just numbers. You could tween the corner radius of a rectangle, for example, so it animated from a very square corner to a very round one. You could tween the volume of a sound from low to high or high to low, or fade in or out, or even a pan from the left to right. It's all really about changing values from one known value to another value, usually over a known time or a specific rate. Now, where do we get this word tween? Well, I'm sure a lot of you already know this, but you're going to hear me say it anyway. This goes back to the early days of animation when everything was drawn by hand. Animations would run at speeds of up to 30 frames per second, and every one of those characters in the movies would have to be individually drawn, up to 30 individual times for every single second of that animation. Of course, lots of tricks were used. If a character was standing still and talking, maybe only his head and hands might move. But it was still a ton of drawing. So the very best animators, i.e. the most highly paid ones, would do the most important frames of the animation. The hand is over here in this spot, and in another frame, the hand is over here in this spot. These came to be known as the keyframes. Then, other lower-paid animators would come in and do all the frames in between those two. Those were the in-between frames, or tweens. The term was popularized well beyond the film industry by the Flash authoring tool, which gave you a timeline, let you draw or position objects on key frames, and would automatically fill in the tweens for you. As Flash became more of a programming tool with its own language, ActionScript, and outgrew the authoring tool it originated with, people wanted to do tweens by code alone. And various libraries sprung up called tweening libraries. Now, a while back, I covered the subject of linear interpolation in one of the Coding Math minis. In that, I did a demo of just this kind of thing. Took an object with a starting point and an ending point, and a value called t that went from 0 to 1, and used that to interpolate smoothly between the starting and ending points. And I did it not only with position, but scale and alpha as well. And that right there is tweening. Done. See you next week. No, wait, there's actually more. That's tweening, but it's in its barest state. That would be called linear tweening because the values linearly increase or decrease from the starting value to the ending value. It's cool enough, but for most motion, it just doesn't look right. I want to say it looks mechanical, but it's even beyond mechanical. It's completely artificial, because even machines don't move like that. So what's the difference between a linear tween and real-life motion? Well, imagine that you jump in your car, start it up, and start driving to work. Do you instantly go from standing still to moving at 30 miles per hour? And when you get to the office, do you drive up to it doing 30 miles an hour still, and then stop on a dime? If you tried either one of these things, the only thing you'd really accomplish for sure is leaving a good percentage of the rubber from your tires smeared on the road. In reality, you'd start at zero, slowly increase your speed to 5, 10, 20 miles per hour, and eventually make it up to 30. Assuming no traffic lights, no stop signs or traffic, you'd continue on that speed until you got near the office, and then slow down to 25, 15, 10, 5, and finally stop, hopefully in a parking space within a reasonable distance from the front door. Now, anything that moves or stops goes through the same process of starting, accelerating, moving, decelerating, and stopping. A bullet coming out of a gun accelerates so rapidly that it seems like it's instantly going at top speed, but it actually takes a short amount of time to get up to that speed. A car hitting a solid wall decelerates rapidly too, though it seems like it stops instantly. Those are the extremes. In most other examples, you see the speeding up and slowing down more clearly. So if we want to create more realistic tweens, we need to ease into that motion when we start, and ease out of it when we're going to come to a stop. Aha, now we know what easing is. So easing is another word that got its usage boosted through the Flash authoring tool. In Flash, when you created a tween on the timeline, you could adjust how much it eases in or eases out, as you can see here. You can see the difference this makes in the tween. It either starts out slowly and moves up to full speed, or starts out at full speed and slows down as it hits the final frame. Unfortunately, you couldn't do both with older Flash tweens. This easing became a big part of ActionScript's tween libraries that began to pop up, particularly aided by a series of equations released by Robert Penner, which you'll still see all over the place, such as Core Animation in iOS, in Object Animator in Java for Android, and jQuery for the web, as well as many others. We'll dive a bit more into those easing formulas in a future video, but for the rest of this episode, I want to take a quick look at what I've always called simple easing and Robert Penner calls the standard exponential slide in his book. This technique is drop-dead easy to implement on any property you want and gives really good results. Personally, I almost always use this as a first attempt whenever I need to ease some object into place. And most often it works just fine, and I can make do without any other more advanced tweening library. Now the concept of this relates to the Greek philosopher Zeno, who was really into paradoxes. This particular paradox states that before you can arrive at a destination, you need to travel from where you are to a halfway point. Then when you're at that halfway point, you need to travel from that point to the halfway point between there and the final destination. Then halfway from there, and so on. Now since no matter how close you get, you can always theoretically break the remaining distance down to give you another halfway point, you can never reach your destination. It's a paradox because obviously people and things do get places, but paradox or not, you should notice that each successive step is smaller and smaller. If we consider this image as the graph of a coded animation, and each step was one frame of that animation, you can see that the object would be moving slower and slower and eventually reaching this target here. So for crying out loud, let's write some code already. We'll start with the basic animation template, and I'll add a target object. This will just be a point over on the right side of the canvas. Then I'll add a position point over here on the left side of the canvas. Now remember that we're going to be traveling half the distance from our current location to the target on each frame. So I'll make a variable called ease and set that to 0.5 to represent that half. In the update function, let's just draw an arc at the xy point defined by the position. Then I'll get the distance from the object to the target. We'll jump right into two dimensions here, so I'll get dx for the x distance and dy for the y distance. Once I have the distances, I can make a velocity on each axis on this frame by multiplying the distance by that ease variable. So we have vx equals dx times ease, and vy equals dy times ease. Then I can simply add that velocity to the position to update the position for the next frame. Let's see what this looks like. I'll refresh the page a few times, and you can see that the circle instantly jumps halfway across the screen, then to the 3/4 point, then 7/8, and so on. It stops right at that right-hand edge, but it's still moving way too fast to be a decent ease. So let's try changing that ease value down to something like 0.1. Well, that's a whole lot better. You can now see the circle kind of sliding into position. Try setting ease even smaller, like 0.01. Now it eases in really slowly, and you begin to feel maybe Zeno was right about it being impossible to arrive anywhere. But let's set it back to 0.1 and try to make this a bit more dynamic. I'll add an event listener for the click event, and when that happens, I'll set the target X and Y to the location of the click. Run that on the browser. Now, each time I click on the screen, the circle starts easing towards exactly where I clicked. Now, just for fun, let's change that click event into a mouse move event. Now we have an object that follows the mouse around. Now, there's a lot more we can do with this and a lot more we need to cover on this subject, but I think that's enough for a comeback episode. See you next week.